Hello, aspirants. Looking at current affairs for 29th Jan, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 13. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Shopian firing. Jammu and Kashmir police charge army unit major with murder. So a case, FIR has been launched by the police in Jammu and Kashmir against the army and the major who were involved in this firing incident on protesters in Shopian. Two civilians, they were young students who died in this. They opened fire on a stone throwing protesters in Shopian. So the army has said that it fired in self-defense when the protesters were indulging in intense stone pelting. They were attempting to lynch an injured junior commissioner officer. So they have set the army vehicles on fire too. So this is a justification being given. The Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir, Ms. Mehbooba Mufti, she has ordered a magisterial inquiry into the matter and has also spoken to the Union Defence Minister, Nirmala Sitharaman. So this is the Shopian region here in Jammu and Kashmir near the POK. Then next is plea to exclude SC/ST creamy layer from quota. So the Supreme Court is going to hear a petition now for the first time to exclude the affluent members or the creamy layer of SCs and STs. You should know creamy layer criteria was there only for OBCs. Till date it is there only for OBCs, not for SC/STs. But this petition is demanding that the creamy layer should be applicable to SCs and STs too, because they are snatching away, the creamy layer of SC/ST is snatching away the benefits. More than 95% is claimed that the benefits are taken away by the affluent. So then there is lack of percolation of benefits to the poor and really backward among these communities. So this, it also says, has led to social unrest, Naxalite movement and perennial poverty. So that is why this case is being heard now. A judgment in 1992 by a 9-judge bench in the Indira Soni case, which is also famously known as Mandal case. It upheld caste-based reservation for OBCs as valid and it excluded creamy layer of OBCs. And this creamy layer is on the basis of specific, you know, limit, income limit as such. So OBCs creamy layer cannot get reservation benefits. Same way SC/ST creamy layer should also not get reservation benefit is the demand being made now. So this is there another judgment which has been cited by the petition is M. Nagaraj case judgment, in which the means test was put forth in 2006. So this is a scrutiny of the value of assets of an individual claiming reservation. So this means test should be applicable for SCs and STs too is being highlighted. So this is regarding the Indira Soni case. The key points: it excluded creamy layer from acquired classes. It declared that there should be no reservation in promotions, and foremost, it said that the total reservation should not exceed 50%, even with carry forward. So this is there, which is this Indira Soni case, famously known as Mandal Commission case. So this was based on, you know, the Mandal Commission, which recommended 27% reservation for socially and educationally backward classes, the OBCs. So this was put into effect by VP Singh government in 1990. Then next is all borders to be fenced, says Rijiju. So here the Minister of State for Home Affairs, Kiran Rijiju, has said that by end of 2018 or by early 2019, smart fencing will be deployed along the entire Indo-Pakistan and Indo-Bangladesh border. So this will prevent infiltration and illegal migration. So smart border fencing technology has been introduced in some regions along the borders here, and BSF has been given the mandate that they have to test the technology, and they have found this technology effective. Also, Mr. Rijiju says that the border is porous in Myanmar because there is a visa-free regime here along India-Myanmar border because of a treaty. So here also steps need to be taken. Another point which is being spoken of is regarding the CISF, Central Industrial Security Force. So the CISF has been, it has been decided to be charged with security to at all airports in the country. Also, VIP security would be handed over to CISF. So this is one of the paramilitary forces, and in UPSC main syllabus, paramilitary forces is part of the topic. So here you can see CISF, which is an armed police force established in its present form in 1983, though originally established in 1960s. It's directly under the Union Ministry of Home Affairs. It provides security cover to industrial units, government infrastructure, and other establishments, atomic power plants, you know, major ports, airports, central PSUs, currency note presses, etc. Also, it provides consultancy services to private industries. Then next is panel to press center for MP's salary hike. So the parliamentary committee on salary and allowances will meet the prime minister, finance minister and parliamentary affairs minister to demand that salary of MPs must be at least 1 rupee more than the salary of the cabinet secretary. So salary of an MP, basic salary is rupees 50,000 and they get a constituency allowance of 45,000. So in 2015, there was a committee established under the head Mr. Yogi Adityanath. It had recommended 100% increase in salary along with increase in allowances also, but the report was not accepted by the government. The recommendation was not accepted by the government. So presently, actually, after the 7th pay commission's recommendations been implemented with effect from 1st Jan 2016, the cabinet secretary, which is the topmost civil servant in the country, topmost bureaucrat, so cabinet secretary's salary is now 2.5 lakh a month. Even a secretary's salary is 2.25 lakh a month. So the MPs are demanding that their salary should be at least equivalent, at least 1 rupee more than that of the cabinet secretary. This is the demand being made now. So here are the details of the salary of an MP is shown. So basic salary is 50,000. Then there are other allowances as such to made office expense allowance, travel allowance, etc. And this is regarding the 7th pay commission's recommendations, after which the salary of a cabinet secretary increased from 90,000 to 2.5 lakhs. Then next is government may tweak insolvency law. So the insolvency and bankruptcy code, which has come into effect from December 2016. So it's been almost, a little more than a year since it has been effective. Now there has already been a panel established, a 14-member panel chaired by Corporate Affairs Secretary, and this is looking into various provisions, and there are recommendations which are expected to be put forth to amend this insolvency and bankruptcy code. So the issues which have been highlighted is that the law is very much in favor of financial creditors and other stakeholders' expectations are not fulfilled. So like, if, for example, in case of realty sector too, in the housing sector, it is seen that the financial creditors, the banks, are benefited, but then the people who have invested in these real estate firms, which are now facing insolvency proceedings, the home buyers are facing the difficulties. So such issues have been highlighted. There are other points also, like competition, regulatory clearances, tax liabilities, etc. So all these would be looked into by this panel and amendments may be suggested to IBC. Then next is PCA, Ministry to Appraise Bank Heads. So the Finance Ministry would initiate a performance review of heads of PSU banks, public sector banks, that are under RBI's prompt corrective action. So 12 public sector banks have been put by the RBI under prompt corrective action because of their poor performance. So they have high levels of NPAs, low capital level, low return on assets. So that is why they have been put under prompt corrective action. There are restrictions on them. So now, on the basis of their performance, now a performance review would be done and some may be removed from this category as well. Also, government is providing bailout to these banks. We have seen recapitalization is being done by the bank, for the bank, public sector banks, by the government. So these 12 banks under PCA are getting commitment from the government as such too. And now a performance review would also be done on them. Then next is Commerce Ministry seeks one GST rate on multimodal vehicles. So the Commerce Ministry has demanded from the Finance Ministry that under GST, there should be a single GST rate for multimodal transportation. Multimodal transportation means using multiple modes of transport like rail, road, sea, etc. So when multimodal transportation is involved, then the logistics, how does it take care of it? So this logistics services, what should be the GST rate applicable, and becomes cumbersome. So that's why this demand has been made. There should be single GST rate for these services. Presently, it is said there is no clearly defined multimodal GST structure in place. Then next is textile sector seeks a leg up from government. So the textile sector is also facing trouble and is expecting benefits for themselves in the present budget. So the ready-made garment exports actually have not increased up to the expected levels. The growth rate has reduced drastically. Fabric exports have also been seeing a slump. Yarn exports are suffering. Even it is said that countries such as Vietnam have taken over India in yarn exports to China as well. So there, the textile sector has been hit by global economic slowdown 7 years ago, and still it needs time to recover. The center had given out a time-bound stimulus package then. So now similar stimulus package is required for the textile sector, with special focus on power looms, technology upgradation and export promotion. So these are the demands being made. So here the details are also provided about the budgetary support expected as such too. Then next is Trans-Pacific Pact could hurt India. So the Trans-Pacific Pact, which actually comprised of 12 countries, but USA has withdrawn. So now there are 11 countries in this. USA withdrew, saying that if the Trans-Pacific Pact is having substantial benefits for America, then he may consider rejoining it too. So even the other 11 countries are now expected to ink an amended version of this partnership as such too in March 2018. So, Trans-Pacific Partnership does not have India. It's a free trade agreement. It's a mega regional free trade agreement. So, India is out of it. So, there's a book which has presently been released which says that India would have been severely hurt if it would have joined Trans-Pacific Partnership. So, it in a way justifies US President Donald Trump's decision too, that it does not have benefits for his country as he claims. So here also in India, it is expected that even in agriculture sector, farmers would be exposed to risks of the market, being flooded by cheap and subsidized exports from countries like US, Australia, New Zealand. So that would affect Indian, sectors like even agriculture, manufacturing, services, even generic pharma industry would suffer, has been claimed. So this is the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So the 11 remaining members are shown here, as you can see. The only one which has pulled out is US. Then next is electric vehicles. Charging infrastructure needs a jolt to meet 2030 target. So there's a target which has been highlighted by various ministers, including the Prime Minister, that there should be all electric vehicles by 2030. But then the sector says to meet this target, there is substantial push required by the government and the private sector. Charging infrastructure is required, cheaper availability of raw materials is required, incentives are required. So even electric vehicles have been given a boost by this government firm, Energy Efficiency Services Limited, which came out with a tender recently, which was given to Tata Motors, Mahindra and Mahindra. So these tenders which have been given, the idea is that they will lease vehicles out to government departments, so that present petrol and diesel vehicles in government departments can be replaced by electric vehicles. Also, we have already discussed regarding FAME, fast adoption and manufacturing of hybrid and electric vehicles in India, the FAME scheme under National Electric Mobility Mission Plan. So this scheme also has four focus areas: technology development, pilot project, charging infrastructure and demand creation. So scheme presently has been extended up to March 31, 2018. We have recently discussed that it should be applicable for at least 5 years, so it's there for 2 more months now. So charging infrastructure is required. People actually, even GST regime is unfavorable, because electric vehicles are taxed at 12% and hybrid vehicles are taxed at 28% plus cess, 15% cess. So this also is being criticized, because it is said that people are still skeptical to shift to all electric vehicles, because they fear that the charge duration of the batteries may not be sufficient. So they are more likely to try hybrid vehicles first. But when hybrid vehicles are taxed at such high rates, then the entire sector gets discouraged. And also the government needs to invest in charging infrastructure. So those steps have been taken. Pilot projects have been initiated by the government in Bengaluru. Even private sector is coming forth. There's more that needs to be done. Also, electric vehicles can be charged at home too using AC power, but that will take a lot of time. So DC chargers can take very less time, but presently, like charging infrastructure installed is all AC. So that has also been highlighted. Then next is NASA keen on India-made technology for spacecraft. So there is this new technology, new thermal spray coating technology. This has been developed for, you know, gas turbine engines in spacecraft by a Rajasthan-based researcher, Dr. Satish Dela. So this was officially published, and a NASA scientist has also come across it and has written a letter. A mail has been sent to this researcher from India showing interest in this technology. Even Indian researchers working in CSIR, DRDO have been equally impressed by this new technology. So actually, this coating, spray coating, is required in, you know, in these gas turbine engines in spacecraft. And this spray coating actually have to be segmented. So there's controlled segmentation which is required. So these are vertical cracks, segmentations which are required in the coating. So these are beneficial for gas turbine engines in spacecraft. But then presently, to generate these cracks during the coating deposition process, a huge amount of, you know, energy is used, and it's a very expensive process. You know, it costs several crores of rupees. But now this new technology which has been developed will be much cheaper and easier. So it will reduce the cost by almost 50%. So this is the new thermal spray coating technology. Then next is the last news item. Rare super blue moon, super blood blue moon visible on Jan 31. So on 31st Jan, an event called super blood blue moon would take place, which will be visible in Western Northern America, Asia, some parts of Asia, Middle East, Russia and Australia. So three unusual lunar events will actually merge. It's a blue moon too. What is a blue moon? Blue moon is second full moon in a month. So blue moon is also there. And blue moon actually takes place every 2 years in 8 months. That in 1 month itself, you have second full moon. So it will be a blue moon. It will be a super moon too. Super moon means when moon is close to the earth in its orbit. So it's an elliptical orbit. So when it is at perigee, a point where moon is closer to the earth. So here moon appears 14% larger and 30% brighter. So it's super moon also. It's a blue moon as well as it's a lunar eclipse. So this total lunar eclipse should also take place. So this is called super blood blue moon. So this lunar eclipse, you should know, it occurs at least twice a year. Super moons can happen 4 to 6 times a year. And blue moon can happens every 2 years and 8 months. So on 31st January, all three events will merge. So this is a super blue blood moon. So this is explained once again here, you can see. Super moon when it is at perigee. Blue moon, two full moons in 1 month, and blood moon means this is the lunar, during a lunar eclipse, moon looks reddish and it passes through the earth's shadow. The last such incident happened in 1866, last such event. So this is super blue blood moon. So these are the news items. Thank you.